May I also remind you that if you'd like to register for the visit to the Fondazione Cini Library and Homo Faber exhibition, you should do it before leaving the room, please, as Fondazione Cini will need the complete list by tomorrow morning. So please do register before moving to the exhibition in the Correr. It is now my greatest pleasure and honor to introduce you Martin Stockhoff. He is professor of philosophy at the University of Amsterdam, and he is the European Research Council Vice President in charge of the Social Sciences and Humanities section, the session which awarded us the wonderful grants we all here to celebrate. And he will offer us a very inside views of the working of the European Research Council. Martin.
Thank you, first of all, Professor Dondi, for the invitation. It's always a pleasure to be invited to tell researchers about the European Research Council, but to be invited to do it in a wonderful place like this, of course, adds to the pleasure of having received this invitation, so thank you. In this short talk, I will review some of the main characteristics that have made the ERC into the successful funding organization that it is. But I also want to briefly look at the ERC from a different angle, which is that of a European project. And I want to argue that some of the added value of the European Research Council for Europe also resides in the contribution that it might make to the creation of something like a European identity. But I start with the ERC as a funding organization. Some of you will be familiar with what I'm going to say, but for those of you who haven't been engaged with the ERC, I give you an overview of some key characteristics. The funding schemes that are run by the ERC have a number of distinctive features that really distinguish it from funding schemes run by other funding organizations. They are, first of all, strictly bottom-up. They focus on excellence only. They are centered, in almost all cases, around a single principal investigator. And they are strictly competitive, so they're not collaborative. Now, strictly bottom-up means that there are no predetermined topics, themes, or areas. The content of the projects that the ERC funds is determined by the researchers themselves. It also means that there are no predetermined budgets set aside for specific disciplines or areas of research. The ERC's operations are organized in three domains: the physical sciences and engineering, life sciences, and social science and humanities. But the budgets of these domains and the budgets of the various panels within these domains are completely demand-driven. And I'm told that that makes the ERC the biggest social science and humanities funding organization in the world. So that's the bottom up. The focus on excellence only means that it is solely the quality of the application that determines the funding decision. It's the innovative nature of the project and the qualifications of the principal investigator. These are the only factors that the panels take into account when they make their funding decisions. It also means that the ERC does not interfere with the work of the experts that sit on the panels. It goes at great lengths to select highly qualified researchers to do the job, but it trusts them to make the appropriate decisions in line with the ERC's mission. So there's no control or correction after the panels have done their job. The third characteristic is that the focus on a single principal investigator. The major funding schemes are all designed for a single principal investigator, the exception being the synergy scheme that targets projects that require the expertise of several principal investigators. But that doesn't make Synergy into a collaborative scheme. It is still completely competitive. And competitiveness means that there are no restrictions or demands, for example, on the countries in which the PIs are located, or on their nationality, or on the composition of their teams whatsoever. In order to make the competition fair, the single PI schemes are oriented towards early career, mid-career, and advanced career stages. But within those boundaries, it's only the quality of the application and of the applicant that counts. Now, in the implementation and execution of these funding schemes, the ESC tries as much as possible to place the researcher center stage. It aims to be a funding organization for scientists by scientists, and it tries to minimize the administrative overhead while, of course, maintaining adequate levels of accountability and transparency. But it's the scientific council of the ERC that is in charge of the way in which the funding schemes are run, what they are, the criteria, and so on and so forth. It's not judged up to the bureaucrats, but it's done by the researchers themselves. Now, judging by the results, the ERC appears to be a successful enterprise. Since its start in 2007, it has funded over 8,500 researchers, and that includes an additional 50,000 researchers as team members. So almost close to 60,000 people have been funded by the ERC in the last 11 years. And there are several indicators that show that the ERC is also successful in executing its core mission, which is to fund world-class frontier research. For example, among the grantees, six have won a Nobel Prize after getting their ERC grants. Five were awarded a Fields Medal, the highest honor in mathematics. Five were Wolf Prize winners. Perhaps more telling, because it's more general, over 7% of the ERC-funded publications are among the top 1% cited in their respective fields. So you could read that with a certain sleight of hand as that ERC researchers are seven times better than average, which is pretty impressive. Qualitative post hoc evaluation by independent experts have identified some 79% of completed projects as being either a scientific breakthrough or as having resulted in major scientific advances in their fields. There are also several other more indirect indicators of impact. For example, several national funding organizations have schemes to finance projects that have gotten an A qualification, so that means fundable, from their ERC panel, but that could not be funded due to lack of ERC resources. Other organizations finance visits, usually from early career researchers, to ERC-funded projects in order to help them prepare a successful application. And universities compete with the number of ERC-funded projects that they host, and sometimes they are actively engaged in trying to attract ERC grantees in order to boost their figure and their status. To have secured ERC funding is, for mid-career researchers, a definite career boost. Several investigations have shown that. And for early career researchers, it's often the decisive factor that determines whether they can stay in academia on the tenure track position to begin with. So the ERC is regarded as a big success. It has been referred to by Carlos Moedas, the European Commissioner for Research and Innovation, as the jewel in the crown, and it enjoys broad support from the scientific communities that it serves. Yet it is not entirely obvious at this point in time that it will be allowed to continue to be a success. And there are two main issues on which the ERC, despite its uncontested results, is being challenged. And these are impact and so-called just retour. And let me begin by saying something about the latter. That the different member states would get their money's worth from the programs that they financed was a design feature of the early days of European-level research funding programs. And it made these programs essentially collaborative with lots of constraints to guarantee that everybody got his money back, basically. Now, obviously, that changed in a big way when the ERC was set up as an explicitly purely competitive program aiming solely for excellence of the research that it was supposed to fund. And there is no denying that some countries are definitely more successful than others when it comes to hosting ERC grantees. Now, why that is so is a complex issue involving economic, historical, cultural factors, where we can say that to some extent, the distribution of ERC funding reflects the quality and the resilience of national academic institutions and research infrastructures. These inequalities exist and should be addressed, and they are addressed. And the ERC's governing body, the Scientific Council, contributes to those efforts by supporting various measures that benefit applicants from countries that perform less well. But it does so only insofar as these measures align with its core mission. A return to juste retour would destroy what makes the ERC special and valuable. The other contested feature concerns societal and economic impact. There is an exercise called Science Behind the Projects that is run by the executive agency of the ERC that provides a very detailed picture of how ERC-funded research fits into the overall scientific landscape. It also reveals that quite a number of ERC-funded projects do address big societal and economical challenges, such as related to energy, climate change, migration, health, and so forth. But these projects focus on fundamental scientific aspects of those challenges and aim to push the boundaries of our understanding. And that means that ERC-funded research does have impact, but that this impact will in general be long-term rather than short-term, and hence not easy to predict. And certainly, it makes that impact very hard to use as a predictor of success and hence as a decisive factor in the funding decision. But that is the case with major technological and societal challenges that are driven by frontier research. If you look at the history of major innovations, these usually are based and driven by research that preceded the actual disruptive changes by 10, 20, sometimes 30 or 40 years. It's not to say that the ERC completely ignores potential short-time applications. Grantees can explore the potential of their projects using the proof of concept scheme. What I want to emphasize also is that what is of equal importance, but often not identified as such, is the impact of research that is done in the humanities and social sciences. The relevance of a deeper understanding of historical developments for an informed political debate about issues such as migration or the role of religious identity is, I think, obvious. Or think of the many and complicated factors that determine the acceptance or rejection of technological innovations when dealing with issues such as climate change or with interventions that address a problem like obesity. And I think Professor Bondi's project is another example. By tracing these complex relations that made the printing revolution possible, that show light on how complex these processes are and how difficult they are to predict. Now, there are many examples where frontier bottom-up research does deliver insights and results that are deeply integrated with societal and economic impact. But there is, of course, also research without impact. For example, in pure mathematics, or in my field, in philosophy, or in literary studies, or in astrophysics, for that matter. And that type of research, too, instantiates the human desire to explore, to understand, to push its own boundaries, and thus to contribute to human flourishing. And to set aside some means to allow people to contribute to that is, I would say, a hallmark of a civilized society, and I'm proud that Europe still is such a society. That brings me to my second topic, the ERC as a European project. What I said so far is all from the perspective of funding schemes and funding organizations. But I also want to take this opportunity to briefly touch upon a different way of looking at the ERC. I want to view it as a European project, as an attempt to create a truly transnational European institution and thereby to contribute to the creation of a European identity. Now, of course, contemporary science is an international endeavor, if ever there was one. And that is true not just of research today. The early modern age saw the creation of the community of letters in which intellectuals from across Europe discussed philosophy, religion, politics, and the new natural sciences. And in the days of the first universities during the Middle Ages, students and professors were true vagrants roaming the European continent, searching and spreading knowledge. From that perspective, modern times have been a regress in certain ways. With the advent of the nation state, and later with the onset of the Industrial Revolution, science and learning became also informed by national interest and sometimes by nationalistic motives. The 19th and early 20th century saw fierce competition between European nations for economic and political military hegemony. It also witnessed an increased emphasis on national histories, languages, and cultural production as part of the very definition and maintenance of the nation state and its ethnic, religious, and political ideologies and identities. Now, science has been both an accomplice and a counteracting force in that development. It has, to a certain extent, sustained divisions in Europe, but it has also brought people together across those very same divisions. After the Second World War, a growing sense that there is more that binds us than that separates us has been a driving force between many political and economic developments. In certain scientific domains, for example, in high energy physics or in astronomy, this was reflected already quite early on in the creation of large infrastructures that are supported by many nations and that serve an international community. CERN is perhaps the most telling, but certainly not the only example. With the creation of the first EU-funded framework programs, other domains became involved in this development as well. Larger transnational forms of cooperation in the social sciences and the humanities were created, such as the NORFACE and HERA networks, and research infrastructures that transcend national boundaries were set up. And again, the current project that hosts this this conference is a very good example of that development. Now, initially, the emphasis was on the need for cross-national collaboration and on economic impact. But increasingly, the success of these forms of collaboration pointed toward the possibility of something decidedly different, the idea of a truly European research community, a European research area. And as an element of the complex process of creating a European research area, the ERC can thus also be viewed as part of an attempt to show that the European Union can be and should be more than an economically motivated collaborative framework, that European research can be a community on its own term, with its own identity and institutions that are not derivatives of, and hence dependent on, national identities and national institutions. Now, of course, it's not possible to create a community by sheer will or just by handing out money. It requires a change in mindset of researchers, of administrators, of politicians, and of the public at large. And that is hard work, long-term work, and both the present and the past bear witness to the many challenges that such an endeavor has to face. Now, one would hope that the success of the ERC contributes to the realization of this endeavor. Well, I think the ERC has a distinct contribution to make here. It strengthens and broadens a European community of researchers by increasing mobility, by allowing talented researchers to build research groups that are internationally composed, and by defining the very idea of excellence in a European context. In that sense, I would regard the ERC as truly a European project. It builds a community, that is to say, a consciousness and a web of relations between institutions and individuals that is not national, obviously, but also more than merely supranational. It is European from the ground up. And that strengthens the very concept of what being European is, as it applies both to individuals, communities, and institutions, and thus creates a basic European identity. Now, funding schemes come and go, and funding organizations in the long run do so as well. But if the ERC turns out to have contributed to a sense of European identity, then I think it has made a contribution that goes beyond its core mission, fostering frontier science, and it has made a contribution that will be of lasting importance. Whether it will be allowed to do so depends first and foremost on how well it acquits itself of the task that has been set for it. And everyone involved in the ERC is very much aware of that. But that's only part of the story. It also depends on the political will of the citizens of Europe to look at themselves in a way that transcends national, ethnic, religious boundaries, and that recognizes that behind what defines them lies the promise of a united Europe. And it is my hope that the ERC may continue to contribute to fostering that insight and to strengthening that will. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Stockhoff. Would you like to get questions? Are there any questions? Please. Matilde, grazie. Whoops.
Hello, Keith Adams. If the ERC didn't exist, but there was a wealthy funding organization, perhaps a Getty funding, don't you think we'd have just as good research, and that the fundamental thing is not the Europeanness, but the interpersonal relationships between the collaborators on a project that we've seen much evidence of today?
Yeah, as I said, of course, science is truly an international endeavor. And let me just say, I focused on the European aspect because I think that is important. But just to make that clear, the funding schemes that the ERC runs are open to everybody, as long as a principal investigator, one is willing to spend 50. Host this project at a European institution and spend 50% of the time working on the project at that European host institution. So science is international. But I think that in this day of an age where the tendency to put national interests first, especially in Europe, in the current developments, clearly point in that direction. I think it's important to stress that things like the ERC, and there are also other things that are funded by the European Union, contribute to creating something that is more than just a transaction between national interests. You do something and you get something in return, and you put something in and you get something in return. As a European research community, as part of an international research community, we should be seen as counteracting those forces of nationalistic thinking. And that's why I think and I hope that the ERC can serve as an example of how that would work, or how it actually works. Because if we talk to grantees of the ERC, if you visit projects, you see people from all across the globe, and what binds them is their interest in the questions that they want to solve, and the results that they want to get, and that's how it should be. I hope that that answers your question.
May I add to it that I think it's not irrelevant the collaborative nature of the funding body. In an immeasurable smaller scale, we see that with the consortium of European research libraries. It is a bottom-up collaborative enterprise that really works well because everybody is contributing to it. And I think no individual equivalent, however long-sighted, would probably give the same, apart also from the fact that in the realm of reality, the enormous logistical exercise in terms of collaboration and discussions that has taken the creation of the ERC in the most liberal way would probably be difficult to replicate in reality out of an individual entity. But if there were such thing, it would be wonderful. I mean, more the merrier. Can you think of one?
I'm sure you know all this very, very well, but I'm obviously aware of a lot of ERC-funded projects. And one hears nice things and one hears bad things. There seem to be two principal complaints about ERC-funded projects, and I think their weaknesses are central. Because the ERC model is actually, in a way, the American model. You give very large chunks of money to people who before didn't have that money, and they have to spend it in a certain arc of time. There are two complaints I hear fairly often. The first is not in any way applicable to Christina. I think Christina was the exception, possibly, to this rule, that especially in the humanities, this money arrives in the hands of people who are very bad managers. And there can be some serious administrative problems in the running of some projects. Obviously not all projects, but there does seem to be sometimes a problem in the amount of preparation people have before they receive these monies. The other complaint one inevitably hears is the absence of long-term continuity. In that, I'll just give an example of one project I know about, the Bernstein Memory of Paper project, which is something I've been interested in and I collaborate with. That is a fairly early ERC grant. It was a very important one. It was an innovative project. Of course, the problem is that when ERC money stops, even a project that's very good and very successful suddenly cannot carry on, you see. And I think the European Research Council is aware of this problem, but sometimes you have very good projects, they have their legs chopped out from under them because it's very difficult to get funding again for exactly the same problem, even if that project would have needs precisely to carry on as it is, because it's significant.
Well, let me start with the second problem, the continuity. Yeah, that's definitely, everybody is aware of that. Projects run for 5 years at a maximum. Of course, it's possible if you have a starting grant to get another starting grant, that happens, or a consolidated grant or an advanced grant. But every time you have to face the competition, And that's something that's built into the very essence of the ERC. That is a problem. But we have to realize that if you look at the total research expenditure in the European area, then the ERC represents slightly less than 1% of that. So obviously it can't solve that problem just by itself. Continuity, especially when it comes to things like infrastructures, right? Maintaining databases, keeping them available, keeping them up to date, is a responsibility of other organizations, of the national infrastructures of universities, conglomerates of universities, and so on and so forth. They have difficulty spending the money there, but at least it's in their remit. Your first point, I wouldn't say that the ERC model is the American model, especially not in the humanities, right? If I look at my my American colleagues, they are not used to working in large projects, right? They don't define a research project with a runtime of 5 years involving a couple of postdocs and 3 PhDs and themselves, right? They just want to be left alone and write a beautiful book or a couple of interesting papers, and they do that very well, at least successful among them. So this funding scheme is actually, and that's your second point, so it's sort of, it may be slightly antagonistic to the humanities of old, I would say. I used to spend 6 years of my life before getting involved in the ERC, chairing the humanities division of the Dutch National Science Foundation, the NWO. And we had two slogans at the time, focus and mass. Right? And we were trying to get these very small individual working humanities scholars, getting them used to thinking in terms of larger projects. And that there was opposition to that. People said that's not the way in which humanities work, by which they usually meant that's not the way in which I work or have worked up to now. But with a little incentive here and there, they got used to it. And especially humanities scholars, the Dutch humanities scholars, are disproportionately successful in ERC type schemes. So, yeah, it's get with the program and make the best of it. And I think, I mean, if I look at the portfolio of projects that the ERC funds in the social sciences and in the humanities, I think they're really well-designed programs that don't have this, which is sometimes what people think, well, you put something together and you put a staple through it, and then you have a long-term project. That's not the way it works. I mean, projects that are thought of like that, they never succeed. So I'm completely convinced that there's more than enough evidence that this scale fits the humanities as much as it fits the social sciences, the physical sciences. Of course, in some of the physical sciences, especially in engineering, they say, well, the scale is not large enough. If you look at people working in high energy physics, they have a difficulty of finding small enough projects that they can put to the ERC. Okay, well, you can't please everybody, so they have to get their larger scale funding from elsewhere.
Thank you very much, Professor Stockhoff, for being with us. And with this, I would like to close this day, invite you all to come to the exhibition, and thank you.